with the state city address from Mayor Gary R. McCarthy.
Thank you, Council President Perrazzo, members of the Schenectady City Council, who welcome my wife Caroline, my brother Gregory here tonight, Neil Golub joining us. Neil, I thank you for all that you, your family, the Golub Corporation have done for this city and really the region, and we appreciate your friendship and your ongoing support and advocacy on behalf of our community. Ray Gillen, the chair of Metroplex, he and the Metroplex team really do such a great job. Larry Spring, our superintendent of schools, really just impressive leadership that Larry provides for this community and an example for other districts across the state. Our city court judges, Mark Blanchfield and Bob Hoffman, thank you for joining us. Assembly members Phil Steck and Angelo Santa Barbara, welcome you here, and again, thank you for your past support for this community, and again, look forward to working with you in this legislative session to continue to build on the great record that you've helped us make and that we look forward to continuing. County legislators Karen Johnson, Richard Paterny, and Richard Russo, thank you for joining us. Karen, of course, served here as mayor for 8 years and has just been a truly a great model and for public servants, not only in this community, but really across the state. Our district attorney, Robert Carney, is joining us tonight. Rotterdam town clerk, Diane Marco. Junior Heitel from the Schenectady School Board. Former Rotterdam town supervisor, Frank Del Gallo. I think I saw him here. Richard Naylor, the chair of the Schenectady City Democratic Committee. Mark Egan, the chamber. Steady Mono, the president of Schenectady County Community College. Tom Wynn from National Grid, supposed to be here. If Tom gets up, it's either a signal that I've talked too long or that the ice is building up on some of the power lines. Members of the clergy, Reverend Dix Howard, Pastor Thompson, Reverend Hamilton, Reverend Gauthier, Reverend Schultz, Reverend Roberts, Reverend Jones, Reverend Guang, who's providing the words tonight for the council meeting. David Buco from Gillespie Corporation, another fantastic team and great community partners that have helped provide such transformational projects within this community and the region. Frank Gallo from Cisco, Carter Yepsen from Presidio, Tony Civitello from TransFinder, John Roth from Plank Construction, Haleeb Samuel from S-Cube, and also the newest member of the Board of Commissioners of the Schenectady Municipal Housing Authority, Ryan Lucy from Mid-State Industries, Bill Fabian from NBT Bank, Frank Del Gallo, you know, has a pool company, and also Gary and Gina Cuomo from Cuomo Country Pools are joining us tonight. There's a little known fact in the pool industry, if you buy a pool during a snowstorm, they give you 10% off. So if you want to see Gary or Frank tonight, and in fact, Bill Fabian will probably finance it for you also. Where else could you get a deal like that? Rick Longo from Empire Paving. Rick, we thank you for joining us in the work that you've done in our community. Teresa Pardo from the Center of Technology and Government. Kishore Baglu, who's a former chief technology officer for the state of New York, now is the president of the Cloud and Things and serves on the Schenectady Smart City Advisory Commission. Gene Malloy from Marshall and Sterling. Ray Legier from Legier Restorations. Where's Finance Commissioner Ferrari? I think Mr. Legier is here because we owe him a check for some of the work he did on when we had the flooding in the basement. I should go back to Jean Malloy. She's here also because she's thankful that she did not have a policy on this building when we had the flood. John Kaplan from Red Cap Sales, Tom Nardacci from Gramercy Communications, Mark Little, the former chief technology officer from GE and the chair of the Smart City Commission. Mark, I appreciate the time and effort and your talent that so many great things are happening because of your involvement. Bill Cook, his wife Christine from the Bills with the Letter Carriers. Bill, if you could look into that check that we sent Ray Legere a while ago to see where that is. Robert Mantello from the Bricklayers. P.J. Mullen, the president of the Schenectady PBA. Mike Angelosi, the president of Local 28, of the Schenectady Paid Professional Firefighters. Some of our neighborhood leaders are joining us. Pat Smith, Marva Isaacs, Bob Harvey. Thank you for the work that you do as advocates for your neighborhoods and for the community as a whole. Jim Salingo from the DSIC, Madeline Thor from Habitat for Humanity, and Angelica Morris from the Schenectady Human Rights Commission. I want to thank the rest of the public that is here tonight, and those of us, and those that are watching us on Open Stage Media via public access broadcast. Today we reflect on not only the strong accomplishments of this city in 2016, but also on the great opportunity that lies ahead for us. In the last 6 years, we've strengthened the city's finances while also providing needed tax relief to our residents. We've begun a significant effort to revitalize our neighborhoods by combating blight, investing in more sustainable, environmentally friendly city, and advancing major projects to improve the quality of life for our residents. We've also used technology to put Schenectady at the forefront of the country in public safety and 21st century infrastructure. In 2017, we must build upon this success, remembering our proud history of leadership in technology by committing to keep Schenectady at the cutting edge of modern government. I'm proud to say that Schenectady's finances are strong. 6 years ago, we were faced with difficult decisions. Schenectady's economy and outlook had begun to improve with new leadership in the city and county, Ray Gillen at Metroplex, and our unified economic development team were producing real results. But our city still faced significant financial challenges that were compounded by the Great Recession and the housing crisis. At that time, some claimed the city was destined for over a 50% tax increase. Through hard work, strong fiscal discipline, and innovative initiatives, we proved the naysayers wrong and were able to maintain important city services and provide tax relief. The tax levy today is at its lowest level in at least a decade. This year's total amount to be raised through property taxes is approximately 6.2% less than in 2012. And we've had two consecutive years with a decrease in the tax levy and the tax rate. Additionally, we've held fees flat for 3 years while continuing important infrastructure investments. Our strengthened financial standing has been recognized by both Standard & Poor's and Moody's rating services, with an A long-term rating with a stable outlook and an A3 with a positive outlook, respectively. This progress didn't come by accident, nor did it happen in a single year. We've looked for new ways to perform city functions while protecting services for our residents. This year, we restructured the Office of General Services for an annual savings of over $125,000. This built on our successful plan of bringing the wastewater treatment plant back under city management, a plan that has saved taxpayers over $5.5 million over the last 6 years. And I'm proud to say we have eliminated odor complaints that occurred in the north end of our city. If everyone paid their taxes, every property owner could see a 5% decrease in the taxes they pay. Since becoming mayor, I have implemented new strategies to combat tax delinquency and improve our collectability. though there is still more work to be done, in the past 5 years, these strategies have lowered the delinquency rate by over 20%. Our stronger fiscal status has allowed us to refinance city debt, resulting in savings of more than $1.6 million over a 15-year period. And we're saving $250,000 in the first 2 years alone. We've accomplished these dramatic results despite inequities in the state aid formula. Utica, a city with nearly 5,000 less residents, receives $5 million more in state aid. Niagara Falls, with 17,000 less residents, receives over $6.5 million more in state aid. If Schenectady received the same state aid as Utica, we could cut our property taxes here in the city of Schenectady by over 15%. Additionally, the Schenectady School District, which represents about 52% of the average tax bill, has been shorted by about $62 million a year in foundation aid that the state formula dictates it needs to provide quality education. Again, equitable funding could result in significant tax relief as well as necessary service improvements for our residents. And again, I appreciate our state legislators being here tonight, and we look forward with you working with you this year to address these inequities. This year, we will continue to work hard to diligently protect the city's financial position. I call upon our state leaders again to look at this pressing need. To continue to provide tax relief and establish a stronger future for the city, we must expand the tax base and successfully rehabilitate distressed properties. Throughout the country, cities continue to face the lingering effects of the housing crisis and other contributors to blight. When I became mayor, I instituted a new common sense approach to code enforcement, bringing technology and cross-departmental procedures to provide solutions to this challenge. We compliment the many hardworking families in our city that strive to maintain their properties, but will not tolerate those absentee investors who seek to profit at the cost of our residents through failing to maintain their properties and allowing deteriorating structures to become impediments to improving our neighborhoods. Our partnership with the Center for Technology and Government at the University at Albany showed that the cost of one distressed house can be over $65,000. That includes lost property taxes, the cost of police, fire, code, and other municipal services, including demolition. Lingering vacant and abandoned homes damage neighborhoods, driving up public safety concerns while discouraging investment. Burned out structures create a particular safety hazard in our neighborhoods. When we have a fire that causes major structural damage, the fire chief, the building inspector, and city staff work in a coordinated effort to remove these dangerous structures in an expedited process rather than allowing them to linger as detriments to the neighborhood. In 2016, we removed four of these structures, preventing them from becoming longtime neighborhood burdens. Now Schenectady has become a leader in this strategy to safely remove these structures, including instructing other municipalities on the process that we use here in Schenectady. Additionally, protecting taxpayers from unfairly carrying the burden of these removals, we have filed a total of 11 lawsuits representing over $300,000 in money owed the city of Schenectady for demolishing these structures due to these fires. Understanding there is no single solution to break the cycle, we have undertaken a multifaceted approach that ranges from removal of the worst structures to investing in home ownership and safe and affordable housing. While the work continues, we're seeing results already, and in 2017, we will enhance several of these approaches to continue to improve the quality of life in our neighborhoods. In the past 6 years, we've demolished or in the process of removing 116 dangerous structures from the city. We've achieved this through innovative partnerships, such as working with the Department of Housing and Urban Development to allow Schenectady to proceed with the 108 loan guarantee program and a unique spot blight removal initiative. And thanks in large part to the critical funding support from Attorney General Eric Schneiderman, we have successfully partnered with the Schenectady City IDA, Metroplex, and the Capital Region Land Bank in a coordinated effort to remove blight from the Eastern Avenue corridor. Thanks to this effort, this year, on the site of two formerly deteriorating structures, we will be opening the Tribute Park, a new neighborhood park honoring the many diverse workers in our community. In 2016, we joined Albany and Troy in a nationwide competition for funding of major public art projects. Our region beat out stiff national competition with the Breathing Lights proposal, which is $1 million public art project funded privately through Bloomberg Philanthropies. The program highlighted houses in three cities by figuratively and literally bringing light to these distressed properties. The program brought together dozens of community and government and private sector's partners for 8 months of programming and events including youth projects, building clinics, and policy discussion. Perhaps its most powerful outcome was reminding people of the various complexities involved in housing and the challenges that we face in combating blight. The work of this project goes on as organizers and partners continue to work at leveraging this new focus on these homes, seeking to restore them and improve our neighborhoods. Combating blight requires understanding the complex challenges and bringing together the necessary resources in what is often a frustrating and tedious process to produce a real solution or positive outcome. An example of this is 1575 Santa Fe Street. Who owns 1575 Santa Fe Street? Since it's a zombie property, the answer to that question is more complicated than you think. The property remains in the name of the original 1993 purchasers who bought the property with a 30-year FHA-backed mortgage. The original mortgage company, Source One Mortgage Services, was then bought out by Citigroup. The owners fell behind in their mortgage payments and defaulted sometime in 2011. And at some point between 1999 and 2007, HUD took over the ownership of the loan and contracted yet another bank, Wells Fargo, for servicing of the mortgage until January of 2015, when it was transferred for servicing purposes to yet another bank, who in turn transferred to another bank, Shell Point Mortgage. The property had unpaid taxes in 2015 that became liens, but the liens were paid in 2016 by Wells Fargo. Confusingly, after it was no longer servicing the mortgage on the property. According to HUD, they sold the mortgage in 2014 to yet another out-of-state bank, V Mortgage. Our law department was finally able to track down the owner of the mortgage, Condor Capital, a California bank which refused to do any repair to the property because they're not the owner. Unbelievably, they then asked the city to buy the mortgage from them. The bank finally listed the property for auction last November, but still failed to bring the property up to code and then ultimately canceled the auction. At least 8 banks or agencies were involved in this property, and yet all sought to deny responsibility while the neighbors and the community suffer with this eyesore. In a partnership with the University at Albany and Albany Law School, Schenectady has looked for new ways to tackle some of these complicated challenges. Following one of the recommendations of this program, the city began an abandonment proceeding this month, which will allow the city to take ownership of the property and proceed to demolish it later this year. And if this was just one property, it would be all right. But this is the fact pattern that repeats itself continually through properties throughout this community and other communities and cities across the state and across the country. Thanks to new state legislation, the city is gaining tools to prevent this from happening again. We're looking forward to working closely with the State Department of Financial Services to ensure that mortgage companies either fulfill their obligations as good corporate citizens to maintain properties they have begun foreclosure on, or we will hold them accountable with the $500 a day fine provided in the statute. Judges, I'm not looking to make any ex parte communication with you, but if you happen to hear that, I hope you maybe take some notes. Our assembly members, Angelo Santa Barbara and Phil Steck, co-sponsored this legislation, and hopefully it's going to give us, again, some of that leverage that will allow these properties to be remediated and brought into code-compliant structures in a faster period of time. Additionally, thanks to a $250,000 grant from the Attorney General Snyderman, we will gain additional resources to strengthen our focus on combating zombie and other distressed property issues to ensure more properties are returned to valuable use and to prevent other properties from entering the cycle of decline. Ultimately, demolition is a last resort. As mayor, I've directed the various city departments to work together to find ways to break the cycle that leads to this decline. Beyond demolition, we work to promote home ownership. We invest in helping keep people in their homes. We support seniors and low to moderate income residents with needed home repairs. And we partner with Schenectady County to provide a lead abatement program to make homes safer for residents, and particularly our children. Our award-winning homes program continues to partner with area banks, realtors, and other housing-related entities to help promote and facilitate home ownership in Schenectady. Current residents and newcomers alike can find relevant information regarding housing opportunities, financial assistance, and various program offers to make a better informed decision through our website and monthly open houses. Pictured are three private homes sold in Schenectady that were part of our open house weekends. Additionally, city-owned property sales have grossed over $3.3 million in the last 2 years, creating approximately 80 new owner-occupied homes in the city. Furthermore, our first-time homebuyer program has helped 11 other new homeowners achieve the American dream. Through our partnerships with local housing not-for-profit organizations, we've continued a strong commitment to helping city residents improve their homes, investing nearly $7.5 million in 533 projects throughout all of our city and all of our neighborhoods. In 2016, Schenectady also partnered with Group Cares, a national youth volunteer organization, to host a week-long work camp, which was based out of the Schenectady High School. And again, I thank Larry Spring and school board members that made that possible, because without being able to use the school resources, we wouldn't have been able to bring them here to Schenectady. This program brought 388 young adults from throughout the country to our city to work at 59 sites, providing free repairs to senior citizens. And the estimated impact of the volunteer labor, the materials supplied, and other donations, these young adults made a contribution to this community of over $300,000. Beyond buildings, we have also made a significant commitment to support residents, from youth arts programs to summer jobs to meal sites. In 2016, Schenectady continued its commitment to building a better future through investing in our youth. This year, more than 80 young adults had jobs through our summer jobs program in partnership with Schenectady County. And nearly 2,300 youths were served through our Parks program in conjunction with the Schenectady County Youth Bureau and the Boys and Girls Club. And through our partnership with SICM, more than 2,000 children were fed through the summer lunch program. In addition to the youth program, with our support, the Community Loan Fund of the Capital Region provided about $950,000 in local investment and worked with 300 clients at the Schenectady office on technical assistance, business planning, and various business and not-for-profit topics. Additionally, over 200 individuals were provided with housing counseling to help keep them in their homes. Beyond combating blight, another commitment I have made as mayor is the restoration and improvement of our infrastructure. With the support of the City Council, the past 6 years, we have more than tripled the pace of paving in Schenectady. In total, we have invested more than $17 million in our neighborhood paving, more than 56 miles, and through our continued commitment in securing the federal grants, we plan to pave approximately 13 more miles this year. Modern cities, though, require more than paving. Walkability and bikeability are important considerations for residents as well as businesses looking to relocate. Pedestrian safety is a critical component of these efforts. Last year, we completed the design work for new sidewalks on Grand Boulevard and McClellan Street as part of the Safe Routes to School initiative. This program will improve safety for students who walk to school. Part of creating the city's new bike infrastructure plan, Schenectady conducted several community biking events. In partnership with the Boys and Girls Club of Schenectady, Schenectady County, the Capital District Transportation Committee, and many other groups, we conducted one of the most successful community biking events in the region. Hundreds of participants learned about bike safety, and approximately 200 bike helmets were distributed. The event was so successful, it has become a model for building partnerships to engage the community in bike safety for other villages and cities in this region. This year, we will continue our commitment to ADA enhancement and construct new pedestrian improvements and complete our bike infrastructure plan. Our investments in green infrastructure have increased efficiency and provide long-term environmental benefits. The city's solar array at our Beavis Hill Reservoir produced over 478,000 kilowatt hours of electricity in 2016. That was not quite a full year, so we're looking for that number to go up this year. Our wastewater treatment plant supports regional economic development. It currently serves parts of Glenville, the Village of Scotia, parts of Niskayuna, parts of Rotterdam, and parts of Southern Saratoga County. We are investing $27 million in upgrading this infrastructure and continuing our modernization program. These improvements will alleviate intermittent street flooding, improve energy efficiency, and guard the aquatic habitat in the Mohawk River. This program protects our environment for future generations, lowers costs for our current residents, and opens the door for more local economic development activity. Schenectady was also recognized as a leader in sustainability by the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority. In 2016, with $250,000 in funding through Governor Cuomo's Cleaner, Greener Communities Initiative to assist in making Schenectady an electric vehicle destination. This year, we will work with the public on locations for new charging stations, and we should have 8 city-owned partial hybrid electric vehicles with corresponding charging stations by the end of the year. This program will lower the city's fuel costs, reduce emissions, and encourage continued growth in Schenectady's technology economy. Beyond improving the infrastructure and the use of renewable energy, Schenectady strengthens its commitment to recycling. Residential recycling not only benefits the environment for future generations, but lowers current garbage costs. We have partnered with the Schenectady School District to provide students with information on recycling. We have simplified the process for residents by adopting a single stream recycling. Additionally, we've expanded items that were not recyclable before, which include used pizza boxes. The results have been clear. We've recycled 268 tons more in 2016 than we did in 2015, which saved the taxpayers over $19,000. And this continues our positive trend as recycling has increased by 21% since 2014. I'll recycle this bottle after I'm done. Understanding the importance of a strong park system to the quality of life, we're in the midst of a dramatic and expansive park reinvestment program throughout the city. We've invested $500,000 in improving our neighborhood parks in the last 2 years, and that through every area of the city. And I compliment Rich Paterni, who's a county legislator and chairs our Recreation Advisory Committee, and his team have been very diligent, very systematic in going out and working with the neighbors in identifying what are the unique needs of these local parks, pocket parks, and they've really done a great job in terms of showing that these type of investments add value to the neighborhoods and improve the quality of life. And can we just have a round of applause for Rich and his team? You know, other communities are doing similar things, but they tend to hire consultants. Rich and his team volunteer there. Look at Mark Little and the Energy Advisor, or the Smart City Advisory Commission. They've come forward as volunteers. And again, it really leverages the resources we have, and that we owe all of them a debt of gratitude for their commitment to this community. And we will continue to partner with our neighborhood associations and other volunteers to bring new features, such as the redesign of the Schenectady Dog Park and the repaving of the Woodlawn Park parking lot. And through the support of Assemblymember Phil Steck, we'll move forward with the design of an addition to Steinmetz Park, where we're going to add a senior park there. Additionally, this year we hope to break ground on a redevelopment of Central Park, including supporting the Music Haven current capital campaign to put in new seating. And this is going to be done in conjunction with work at the A Diamond and with the tennis courts there. And in partnership with the YMCA, we will seek funding for renovation of the Jerry Burrell Park in Hamilton Hill. This year, the Gateway Plaza will begin construction on the first phase of its renovation, and the Orchard Park will begin design work on its expansion. Together, these two projects represent a $1.7 million investment in expanding the green space and are important parts of supporting neighborhood redevelopment projects in Lower State Street and along Crane Street, respectively. The next few weeks, we will also be seeking support from the New York State Legislature to allow construction of a new clubhouse for the Schenectady Boys and Girls Club of Schenectady. This is a major investment in our children's future and will allow for more expanded programming and new partnerships with the Schenectady School District to ensure our children have the support and opportunity they need to succeed. This dramatic progress we've seen in Schenectady is made possible by working together. In no place is that more clear in economic development. Over the past decade, we've seen millions of dollars in new investment and thousands of new jobs created. With Ray Gillen leading Metroplex in our continued close partnership with Schenectady County, we have proven that working together works for the residents of our city. 2016 was another year of dramatic economic victories and set the stage for several more to come. GE made a $45 million investment in its downtown campus, and Bechtel announced it's moving 350 jobs to Schenectady, where it will release 73,000 square feet of space. In both these cases, these companies could have made investments almost anywhere in the country, if not the world, but they chose Schenectady over competing sites. The Live-In Schenectady closed on the purchase of vacant city-owned property, making way for an investment of $1.5 million to build new townhouses. This exciting project shows the commitment of over a dozen private investors to Schenectady's continued improvement in our neighborhoods. Other economic development projects include the growth of small tech companies at the Electric City Innovation Center, the relocation of Dumbstruck, S-Cube, Beekman 1802's headquarters to Schenectady, and the opening of the new Marriott Courtyard Hotel. Additionally, P1 Industries received $750,000 for a new 10,000 square foot advanced manufacturing center to be built in the city of Schenectady. In Hamilton Hill, the community builders completed the purchase of their property, allowing them to begin their $20 million investment. And the DePaul Corporation is nearing completion of the Joseph Allen Apartments on Albany Street, another $17 million investment in the neighborhood. Summit Towers has announced a $10 million upgrade, and the former Schaefer Senior Center will undergo a $6 million rehab. The Foster Building on State Street is beginning phase two of its project, including the addition of Sliding Dirty, a restaurant and catering company. The Mill Artisan District received over $2.3 million to renovate buildings on Lower State Street, Mill Lane, and South Church Street in downtown Schenectady. The project will result in more than $10 million in new investment, creating space in renovated buildings for the craft industry and artisans, as well as space for loft housing, tech companies, and artist studios. This project is another great example of the synergy in Schenectady's economic development effort. We're expanding parkland nearby with a new Gateway Plaza. The former Y building is undergoing a major new investment, and Lower State Street has been refurbished. And Schenectady Community College continues to be a major partner in the city and county's economic resurgence. And I thank, again, President Mono for his work and the team that he has in place that continues to complement the efforts of not only the city and the county, but the private sector that is so much a part of this growth that's occurring. None of these projects happened or would have even been possible in a vacuum. The coordination of efforts and cooperation of business, government, and residents made these projects possible. A great example of that cooperation is our redeveloped riverfront. Next month, we'll see the opening of the $330 million Rivers Casino and Resort by Rush Gaming. In addition to its 50,000 square foot first class gaming floor, it will soon open a 65 room hotel with a 10,000 square foot banquet facility capable of hosting up to 900 people. That's designed for conventions and special events. An interesting statistic to put in context this transformational project, construction crews have put in more than 450,000 hours of work on the river site to get it ready for the opening on February 8th. But it's important to note that this project is more than just the casino. The Mohawk Harbor project includes a new tech office building of 100,000 square feet, along with other new retail, apartments, and mixed-use development of this $150 million waterfront investment. Again, I thank David Buco and the Gillespie Corporation for their commitment and their investment here in Schenectady. It began 2016 with the creation of a Schenectady Smart City Advisory Commission to take advantage of new technology for the superior delivery of government services and improve the quality of life. Again, the commission has been led by Mark Little and has helped place Schenectady at the forefront of a variety of technology and sustainability initiatives. The broad concept of smart cities involves creating sustainability, efficiency, and improved quality of life by using technology and innovation. The future of government infrastructure is more than pipes and pavement. It's building a cohesive wireless network and utilizing sustainable technology to lower the burden on residents through more efficient services. By establishing an advisory commission and collaborating with various public and private sector entities, Schenectady has created an environment in which innovation, creativity, and practicality can work together to save money and improve the quality of life. Schenectady is being recognized as a leader in the smart city technology. We have built more than 50 partnerships with private companies, educational institutions, not-for-profits, and other governments and governmental agencies. In response to our efforts, we've been invited to speak at a half dozen regional and national events, and designated for 2 awards, and invited to publish 3 articles on our smart city efforts. Nationwide, people are learning about Schenectady. We got to this point through our early adoption of several significant smart city concepts and by tracking their results. Schenectady has implemented a multi-pronged evidence-based approach specifically designed to reduce serious crime and the related social harms. Through the use of DDACS, it's an acronym for data-driven policing, we continue to make dramatic progress in improving public safety. Schenectady has observed a 20% reduction in Part 1 crime in 2016, again comparing that to a 5-year average. And a breakdown of Part 1 crimes reveals that Schenectady had a 13.7% reduction in violent crime and a 21.8% reduction in property crime. While our overall call volume has remained relatively steady, we've seen a dramatic shift in the type of calls. In 2016, there was a 34.8% increase in police-initiated calls. It's proactive policing rather than reactive policing, and it's critical in successfully preventing crime and addressing and identifying problems early. This shift has also allowed us to continue our significant commitment to community policing. In 2016, Schenectady Police Department continued its bike patrol, attended many community events, and continued the Community Basketball League. In 2017, we look to build on the success of these outreach efforts and continue to expand our efforts in the community. And I compliment Commissioner Bennett and Chief Clifford, who's still learning some of the ropes of the job, but really doing a great job in setting an agenda and doing that outreach in the community. To complement the numbers in the police department, our fire department continues its impressive record. In 2016, our total calls in the fire department were down 3%. Structure fires were down 7%. In false alarm fire calls were down 6%, and there was also a 6% reduction in calls for advanced life support through our paramedic program. What I believe, those are significant numbers where you see the shift in the police calls and the fire calls. It's resulting from the coordinated efforts of working with our building inspector, our code enforcement, the Corporation Council, the police and fire, producing coordinated results where we're trying to solve the problem the first time we go to a property. We're eliminating some of the worst of the worst properties. We're showing people who might choose to engage in conduct that's improper or illegal that we're not going to tolerate it, and that we respond in a manner that creates a level of deterrence and complements those people that do the right thing. Schenectady is a leader in arson investigation. In Schenectady, 70% of arson fires result in an arrest, compared to the nationwide average of only 19%. Schenectady also has a 100% conviction rate of those arrested in arson cases, compared to less than 1% of arson cases nationwide. And we should give our district attorney a round of applause for Schenectady Fire Department also works diligently on fire prevention. In partnership with the Schenectady School District, fire instructors regularly visit all the city schools and educate children of all ages on fire safety. Last year, taking these lessons to heart, a young girl saved her mother's life by following the instructions that she had been taught in these lessons. At the scene, she recognized her instructor, Lieutenant Dercole, and she asked him, "How did I do?" As I'm sure Lieutenant Dercole said, and let me also say to Abigail, she did a great job, and Schenectady is proud of you. And it shows how these things pay off in really significant ways. In October, in conjunction with the American Red Cross, the fire department hosted a smoke detector installation campaign in Schenectady neighborhoods. It's resulted in over 430 smoke detectors being installed throughout the city. These great efforts and the results have been made possible by the diligent workforce that we have and their continued dedication to best practices and data-driven policies. And I compliment Chief Senecal and his team for, again, the impressive work they do every day. In 2016, we undertook several new smart city projects. Last spring, we launched a new website with a host of easy-to-find resources for residents. We also launched our new citizen request tracker, which allows residents from their phones, computers, or tablets to report issues or request city services, and allows the city to use that data to keep improving our response. This year, we look to add new services, such as the optional reminders regarding important dates and online submission of forms and reservations for city park facilities. While simple improvements, a key part of smart city concept is improving citizen access and government responsiveness. And our new website is one of these key steps. We also began to full rollout of our partnership with TransFinder. Working with a local business, we're tracking daily the key data on vehicles to cut fuel usage and improve safety. And I appreciate Antonio Civitella and his team, because this is really a new venture for them, and we're breaking some new ground for the city. And so we're working together in a collaborative effort that benefits both TransFinder and the city of Schenectady. In the next few weeks, we'll be adding public Wi-Fi in front of City Hall and on Lower Union Street for residents, visitors, and businesses. This is only scratching the surface of what is possible through smart city technology. Our partnerships with Cisco, GE, and National Grid, along with others, has allowed for the installation of roughly 200 smart streetlights throughout Schenectady. This project provides the opportunity for municipalities such as Schenectady to reduce expenditures while embracing emerging technologies to improve the delivery of several key services to our residents. The city of Schenectady has approximately 5,100 conventional streetlights. Converting these streetlights to Wi-Fi-enabled LED smart lighting will produce savings, improve maintenance, enhance public safety, and public works, also empowering public employees while conserving natural resources and fostering innovation in both government and the community. While one of the main objectives of this project is to reduce energy consumption, emerging technology allows us to use this project as a platform for real change. Data can be collected and disseminated to users, allowing educated decisions to be made in countless areas. The savings to the city of Schenectady, just from electric usage, is expected to be about $370,000 a year. Case studies show that other long-term cost benefits can be achieved with this technology. We look to evaluate some of these opportunities and quantify the savings that can be derived from them. The yearly energy savings with a switch to smart LED is calculated at over 2 million kilowatt hours of electricity. The greenhouse gas calculator from EPA show this would produce a reduction of about 1,546 tons of carbon dioxide, equivalent to over 3.3 million miles of passenger car travel would be saved every year when the entire project is completed. Since dimming of lights is a built-in capacity of smart lighting, the potential exists to reduce usage even further during off-peak times for greater savings. Maintenance of lighting has always been performed on a reactive basis, waiting for someone to tell us that a street light is non-functioning. These systems will alert us automatically to a failure or even a knockdown, reducing repair times. Video cameras included as part of our scope will have the potential to collect analytic data for traffic, pedestrian volumes, vehicle speeds and delay, parking patterns, and notification of parking violations to public safety. Triggers can be set to notify our police department when a vehicle has not been moved for a predetermined time, indicating a disabled vehicle in a roadway or even an abandoned vehicle in our neighborhoods. Sensors will provide additional data on temperature and road conditions, assisting our road crews with advance notice on trends that can affect our streets and would also allow more effective deployment of city resources to deal with weather-related events. A Wi-Fi component already deployed on a small scale allows our police department to continuously download in-car video to our secure network, reducing downtime of vehicles by allowing them to continue on patrol. City personnel across several departments, including our code enforcement staff, will be able to access data in order to make informed decisions out in the field instead of wasting time returning to their offices. Police and fire department personnel will be able to see housing and building data during emergencies without the need for intervention from others, empowering them to respond more intelligently to incidents and major events. Additionally, internet access is the primary requirement for connected devices. We would use this network to provide communication between our smart devices and an open source platform to collect data and perform predictive analytics. The smart connected street lighting would be the base plan for deployment, as the projected energy savings would help fund some of this project while providing sustainability. Additional services such as the analytic cameras, temperature and motion sensors, traffic monitoring devices, and the potential for interconnected healthcare and other life safety devices deployed on a network of over 5,000 streetlights provide an opportunity to evaluate the deployment of numerous emerging technologies in an urban environment. When we couple this data with information from social services agency, the school district, medical and healthcare providers, and other governmental sources, we can start to look for trends and respond in a proactive way to improve the quality of life and conditions within our community. Having the ability to provide internet access to a segment of our population that currently does not have it would also improve social and economic development within the community. I want to again thank the City Council for the opportunity to address you tonight and for the public for joining us. Schenectady has been known as a leader, and we continue to strive to set an example for others today. From the residents who pick up litter to the large employer who continues to create new ideas and services from Schenectady, together we make the city great. 125 years ago, General Electric began right here in Schenectady. At that time, it was hard to predict the impact in innovative, world-changing products that would come from Schenectady. In many ways, we're at a similar turning point in our history. The world is entering what some are calling the fourth industrial revolution. Others refer to the concept of cities 3.0. But whatever phrase you choose, it is clear that both the private economy and government are at points of dramatic change. The possibility to improve educational outcomes and public health, lower crime, and support economic development are at our fingertips. But we must come together and commit to make the investment to make this possible, or Schenectady will lose its chance to continue as a leader in New York State and the nation as a whole. A decade ago, we ended the gridlock that held back our economic development in our community and created a unified economic development approach that has created thousands of new jobs and has resulted in $1 billion in investment in our community. In the past 5 years, we've changed our approach to blight, resulting in dramatic new residential investment and the removal of deteriorated structures and a new focus on increasing home ownership in our city. Now we must commit ourselves to that same resolve we had to ending the squabbling in economic development. And with the same innovative spirit we use to begin to change the way we deal with blight, to take the next major step forward and truly transform our neighborhoods and the city as a whole. The state of our city is strong. The best days for Schenectady are still ahead, and together we can keep Schenectady moving forward. I thank you for listening tonight and look forward to working with you in the future.
Thank you, Madam President.